Hi, my name is Brent Taylor. I am Managing Director in Consumer Marketplace Insights and Innovation at Altria. Thank you to the GTNF Organizing Committee for inviting me here. I'm sorry I can't be there in person, but I'm glad to be presenting to you virtually today. So one of the things that I want to highlight today is that we need to make sure that the adult smoker's voice is heard and embedded in all of the decision-making that we make with respect to any regulation, innovation, and science discussions for tobacco harm reduction. When we think about tobacco harm reduction, there are really three main pillars: youth smoking prevention, cessation support, and switching adult smokers who currently smoke to reduced-risk alternatives. That last audience is really the audience that I focus on, that I study, and make sure that their voice is heard and embedded in all of the decision-making that we do at Altria to be successful with our vision of transitioning adult smokers to a smoke-free future. When we think about that adult smoker population, I think what we all need to realize is that in the United States, that adult smoker population has been declining over the last several years. However, of the 50 million tobacco consumers, 28 million in the United States are still adult smokers. So that still remains a very sizable population of consumers that we need to focus on, that we need to understand, and we need to be able to transition to smoke-free products to be successful in the future. And when you think about that audience, one of the things that's really critically important to them is that they're really interested in searching for reduced risk smoke-free alternatives. In fact, when we talk to adult smokers and we ask them whether or not they'd be interested in completely switching their cigarette occasions over to smoke-free products, over 50% actually say that they are very interested, extremely interested, or somewhat interested in switching. So a high degree of that 28 million adult smoker population is really interested in switching to smoke-free products. However, as we know, many of them don't. So we really need to continue to understand that audience, understand what motivates them, understand what's holding them back, so that we can design products, design marketing programs to really help and support and facilitate that transition over to smoke-free products. Now again, when thinking about that audience and thinking about the high interest level, there are lots of reasons that adult smokers are really looking to make that transition and make that switch. You know, many of them experience some pressure from the loved ones in their life, so the family and friends that they have really wanting that adult smoker to switch to a non-combustible product. Some of them just simply dislike the smell of smoke. You know, it stays in your clothes, it stays in your hair, and they really want to get away from the odor associated and the image associated with cigarette smoking. Continuing with image, there's obviously a lot of social judgment that adults who smoke feel from pressure in society to change their behavior and actually switch to a smoke-free alternative. So many are looking to get away from that social judgment that they experience and feel. And they just simply want to be free from their smoking behavior. There are lots of things that adult smokers have to do on a daily basis to be an adult smoker, such as leave work, leave a particular situation, walk a distance to be able to go smoke a cigarette. To be free of that behavior can be really liberating for a consumer. They're also just looking for smoke-free products. We're living in a day and age where there are multiple smoke-free options for consumers, and many of these consumers who are interested are simply looking to change and explore in the smoke-free tobacco space. And then for many consumers too, as they age, they believe that smoking no longer fits in that particular life stage for them, and they're really looking to make a change because they don't feel like cigarette smoking continues to fit with the image of who they are today. One of the things you may be asking yourself is why I care so deeply about transitioning adult smokers to smoke-free tobacco products. And the reason I care is because that it's also my own personal journey. About 6 years ago, I transitioned from cigarette smoker over to smoke-free alternatives, and I haven't smoked a single cigarette since that period of time. I do realize that in my current role, I have access to information and access to products that many adult smokers don't have today, so a lot of that helped facilitate that transition for me, but still very proud of the success and really want to make sure that I can do my part to make sure that I can influence others to help support the journey for adult smokers over to smoke-free tobacco products. One of the things I wanted to do personally was really highlight my own journey to the organization. I knew that my own single story would only be so powerful within Altria, so I really wanted to find a way to create a research study to customize that experience and highlight to the organization all of the struggles and motivations that adult smokers have along this journey. The goal of that was really for the organization to be able to build empathy with the adult smoker, step in their shoes, walk a mile in their shoes, and understand what this experience was like. What were the beginning stages like in terms of the motivations that a consumer had? What were the barriers that consumers experienced throughout that particular journey of transitioning to smoke-free products? And then what were the success points when a consumer was done with that transition that really reinforced that behavior and kept them on that journey long term? The project that I designed and my team worked on was called Project 21. At its core, it was relatively simple. We followed 21 adult consumers over 21 days in 2021, hence the name Project 21. And this was really a deep ethnographic study of adult smokers, again, to deeply, deeply understand that journey. We used new technologies in terms of video diaries and ethnographic tools to be able to follow these consumers on a daily basis, had check-ins with them routinely to really understand how this journey was going for them, how we might be able to support them on this journey so that they could ultimately be successful in completely transitioning away from cigarettes. So throughout that period of time, consumers were asked to catalog their behavior. So they talked about the number of cigarettes that they used per day. They talked about the number of occasions of the smoke-free alternative that they used every day so that we could really track their consumption over the course of the period of time to see if they were reducing cigarette consumption and ultimately eliminating cigarette usage in favor of smoke-free products over the course of that study. And then we did also have two additional check-in points with them to make sure that this behavior had lasted a long time. So after that 21-day period, we had a three-month check-in with these consumers, and then we also had a six-month check-in with them as well. So wanted to make sure that we weren't just getting a snapshot over a 21-day period, but that we were really seeing what a longer-term impact that short experience had for those consumers. Some of the key takeaways, the first sounds relatively obvious, but it's possible. We actually had 16 of the 21 consumers switch completely to smoke-free alternatives over the course of the study. So we were very impressed with that number, and the balance actually significantly reduced cigarette consumption. Some of them may have been smoking still a cigarette or two a day, but that's down from about a pack where they started. So they had significantly reduced. So really, really proud of what we saw with this group of consumers. It's about mindset. Consumers will only be able to make this change if they want to make this change. I think we understand that as a fundamental principle of behavioral change. It's really about the mindset and what that consumer is thinking and feeling and how motivated they are to go on this particular path and journey. It's very broadly influenced. There are a number of factors that can influence somebody's success on this journey that have nothing to do with tobacco. You may have just had a bad day that had nothing to do with your cigarettes, but that made you go back and smoke a cigarette at one point of your day. So lots of different things throughout a person's day can affect their success for that particular day and over the course of the journey. It's very surprising. There were a number of things that we didn't even think of that consumers were able to play back as motivators on this particular journey and things that they were surprised about once they eliminated cigarettes. Things like somebody might have had to have lived in an apartment where smoking was allowed, and now that they were no longer a cigarette smoker, they felt like there were many places that they were able to live as a result of that. So it opened up doors for them. Dating was another one we heard about, where as a smoker, they felt that they could only date other smokers, and now they felt like they had a wider pool of people that they could potentially date. So huge impact beyond many of the things that we talk about. This is often a complete holistic life change for a consumer. It requires a support system. We found through the course of this research that the research study itself was acting as a support system for these people. So we ended up talking to them every day, asking them questions every day, and that created a sense of accountability and a support and a bit of a cheerleading team for these people to be able to be so successful towards the end of this particular study. It's liberating. I talked about how this is a holistic transformation for a consumer. It can be liberating in many ways that we uncovered throughout the journey itself. It's very much a change in identity for an adult smoker. You've been categorized as an adult smoker throughout your adult life, and leaving that personality and leaving that persona can be a challenge for some, but many end up embracing that new identity that they create now as somebody who only uses smoke-free products. And it's very emotional and it's very complicated. So as we think about this journey, there are many ups and downs that a consumer can experience throughout their daily life. All of that affects their success on this journey. And then it's very complicated. There is no single way that each of these consumers approach this journey. Some people took a hard and fast rule on day one where they were going to try to eliminate all cigarettes immediately in favor of smoke-free products. Other consumers had a more progressive approach where they tried to cut back every day in favor of smoke-free tobacco products to get them ultimately to that place of success. So I think it's really important to understand that every person is going to approach this in a different and unique way that works for them. So now that we had a much deeper understanding of these consumers, what they were looking for, what this journey is about for these consumers, and how we might be able to support them in terms of their success on this journey, we now need to ask ourselves, how can we take what is a small-scale study of 21 people, and how can we broaden that and scale it to really accelerate harm reduction in the United States and globally? I think the first is, and this connects back to the point that I was saying about it being unique, is we need to recognize that adult smokers are not a monolith, right? They are people, they represent a vast cross-section of adults that represent different races, different incomes, different genders, and we need to make sure that we identify what types of clusters or segments might exist among that population so that we can design messaging, design products that really cater to different types of people. So some of the things we look at are things like, do consumers look for familiar experiences that might be closer into the cigarette to replace that cigarette experience? Or are they looking for something that's completely different from the cigarette, that kind of takes them away from that cigarette space, and they're much more willing to adopt and embrace innovation? There are people who have different values and different attitudes, whether or not they're individualistic or more community-minded. They're all going to be responding and looking for different types of messaging, different types of marketing communications to really connect with them and help facilitate that transition for them. So I think first and foremost, we need to understand all adult smokers are not the same, and we need to take time to understand them, take time to connect with them, and really figure out what they need in this space and cater programs and products to those consumers. After we've looked at the adult smoker and understand the different segments that exist, we need to understand how they're using tobacco products and how they're using their cigarette products today. There are a number of moments that we've identified, and those moments fall into two large categories. There are moments there where an adult smoker uses cigarettes to detach from the world, and there's moments where adult smokers use cigarettes to engage with the world. I'll give a couple of high-level examples, but if you want to think about the break, right? I think that is the quintessential cigarette moment. It's where a consumer is really looking to detach from the world. The cigarette is essential to that experience. It is very much the focus of that experience, and it's a moment for that consumer to kind of take a break, reground, and then kind of go back to whatever they were doing for that particular, prior to actually taking that break. Then there are moments like the hangout moment, which fall on the other end, where those adult smokers are really looking to engage with other people. And the cigarette kind of is to the side in that moment, right? They're using a cigarette, they're smoking a cigarette, but it's not the star of that particular occasion in the same way that it is with the break. So there are different types of occasions, different emotional spaces that an adult smoker might be in. So as you start to layer these together, you can see that there are different types of adult smokers who are using products at different times throughout the day, and then you can start to understand what the particular motivators are and what the particular barriers are for each particular occasion. So as you think about that intersection, the motivators that you might have in a hangout moment are going to be very different than the motivators to switch to a smoke-free product that you might have during a break moment. So we really need to start thinking about a portfolio of products to address the needs of consumers throughout the day. I think an easy way for people to understand this is to think about the beverage category. In thinking about the beverage category and connecting that to the tobacco space is really starting to behave that way with a proliferation of options in the marketplace for consumers, where consumers might choose a different type of product first thing in the morning versus throughout their workday versus in the evening. So we really need to make sure we take a portfolio approach when approaching the needs of consumers and the preferences that they have throughout their day. And innovating in those moments so that we can create the best products for those consumers during those particular moments throughout the day. As I mentioned before, one of the key responsibilities that I have at Altria is understanding the consumer, understanding the adult smoker, and making sure that voice is heard and embedded in the decision-making that we make as a company. As part of that, we really need to make sure that we're staying in constant communication with adult smokers and hearing what they're looking for in the marketplace today. They're really looking for three things to really help facilitate that transition from combustible products over to smoke-free tobacco products. The first is that they are very much in favor of harm reduction over prohibitionist measures, so they're wanting to make sure that there are programs and products that will help support that transition from being an adult smoker over to smoke-free tobacco products versus things like bans. They also want options in the marketplace, so they want the availability of the products to be able to choose those products throughout the moments of the day where those different types of products might work best for them. And then lastly, we all know that there are many misperceptions around nicotine and the harm associated with nicotine. As you can see, 80% of the adult smokers that we talked to in this particular study believe that nicotine is a carcinogen. We really need to work hard to make sure that that information is clarified for the consumer so that they can make an informed choice in the marketplace. So in summary, this is an issue that I feel very passionate about. I really want to make sure that the consumer's voice is always heard in all of our discussions around regulation, innovation, and science in the tobacco industry. And I think the key is always start with the consumer. When you're having a conversation about any particular issue, make sure you consider the consumer's voice in that discussion, amplify that voice so that it's heard. And what do we really need to do? We really need to do three things. First is deeply understand and connect with the consumer so that we have empathy. And that empathy will really allow us to think through strategies, think through portfolio innovation, think through marketing initiatives that can really help support and guide that consumer to a smoke-free future. And then there are two things that consumers are really asking for in this marketplace. The first are options. So they want authorized smoke-free tobacco products in the marketplace that they can choose instead of cigarettes. And then the last is they need to have accurate information. So today, they don't have accurate information about the products that they're consuming. We really need to make sure that they have that accurate information so they can make informed decisions and informed choices in the market. Thank you. It was a pleasure being here today virtually. Enjoy the rest of the conference.